I've been singing all my life, and it's been pretty much the biggest solace for me.
Can't think of anything I'd like to do better, really. So I'm gonna stick with it.
I had no clue what to expect, but it happened, so here I am.
I think this is important for a feminist stance. I often think it's important for a musical stance.
We're criticized for absolutely every reason.
I don't write music for women. I write music for people.
I didn't feel like I deserved it.
I think a lot of other people would have sent me home.
There certainly seems to be a recurring theme of nudity, isn't there?
Never wanted to be famous. I wanted to make music.
Being an icon thing is just too weird for me. I don't even really, it doesn't compute.
I'm just still Sarah from the block, you know,
I'm just still me.
The first time I got on stage, right then and there, I knew that I wanted to be a performer. I had no idea that I'd actually ever really do it.
Music has always been a backdrop to every experience that I've had, and it's sort of always been a constant in my life. It's the one thing that I knew that I was good at when I was an awkward teenager, getting beat up and called all sorts of names, and I knew I was good at it. It sort of fed me. It kept me going.
I think the first lyricist that really got me was Peter Gabriel.
I saw Peter Gabriel on television, and I saw Shock the Monkey at the same time. Wow, what have I been missing?
It worked for me perfectly, and I thought, that's what I want to do. I don't want to copy him, I just want to, you know, whatever he's doing to me, that's what I want to do.
And then I started listening to Kate Bush, because I heard Kate Bush on one of his records. I really saturated myself with those two for a long time. I fall into the water,
and once more I turn to you. I did a lot of classical recitals when I was young, and if that doesn't ruin you for music, I don't know what does. Sometimes, because they're quite traumatic. You have to sit there with all the other parents, and they don't care if you do good. As a matter of fact, they want you to fail because they want their kids to do good. And it's a lot of pressure. The first gig we ever played was the Dalhousie Sub in Halifax. There was about 400 people there. It was the most exciting feeling I'd ever felt in my life. So I'd say that's when I realized my true calling, that this was exactly what I wanted to do and where I wanted to be.
It was the biggest traumatic event of my life at 17 when my parents said, no way, you can't go to Vancouver. But in retrospect, I'm so glad they did, because I was completely unprepared. And I was just too young and too messed up. And I would have made a mess of things, I'm sure. So I was a little better prepared at 19.
Mark saw a certain raw talent there. And, you know, he didn't know exactly what he was going to do with it or how to try and, you know, shape it. He just saw something there, and that was all he had to see. So there was no demos, nothing. She'd never written a song in her life. We'll never see a major label taking that chance.
He took me out to their tour van, sat me down, and offered me a 5-record contract. So I got a lawyer, looked at the contracts, and signed them, and I moved out to Vancouver.
I came onto the scene completely green and naive. I just started writing songs when I got the record contract. Didn't have any idea how the industry worked, and I was very lucky to get signed to an independent label that gave me creative control. But when the majors got involved, yeah, they were like, okay, where are the singles? You can yodel on the rest of the record for all I care, as long as we have the 3 singles. And it was kind of shocking to me, but, you know, as a good education, a good kind of smack in the face of this is how it works.
The
before I even understood the power of image. I just wanted to be, well, this is who I am, this is what I want to project, and that's sort of where it went. And it took me a long time to understand how important and powerful that, or those few images are.
There certainly seems to be a recurring theme of nudity, isn't there?
What was the motivation?
Non-gratuitous nudity.
I don't know how anybody else could possibly be shocked.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal. Oh, I'm hiding my nudity.
Yeah.
I'm not exposing myself. I'm humbled, for Christ's sake. I don't know why everybody makes such a big deal about it. The immediate reaction was, oh, she's sold out. She's selling her body. It was about just being in a natural state. And it was incredibly naive of me to think that way. And that was a real eye-opener for me. She's loaded deep,
as deep can be. Now, I do think that in the industry's eyes, things did change. New formats were developed in radio. The old school attitudes of you can't play two women back to back, obviously, we changed that. I do feel, however, that, you know, the day Lilith ended, the door slammed shut. In some ways, it just seemed like musically, that was the real beginning of the Britney, Christina, Beyoncé, all this just wildly sexual marketed stuff. And then the angry white male band. All of a sudden, it's like, wow, okay, things have changed really quickly. I'd rather just do it a little more subtly. It has nothing to do with music anymore, you know. It's just all about creating this image that boys are going to drool over and girls are going to want to be. It's not something that I hope my daughter aspires towards, that's for sure. As far as me in the video, I've always done it for artistic reasons. I mean, my dad just shakes his head at me when I say that, and he goes, there's no need for that, little girl. He's never gonna like it.
I know I can't change the way you feel.
I would actually get angry at people. Not to their face, but afterwards, because they'd be telling me how fantastic it was, and I felt horrible about myself. I started losing myself and started buying into all the things people were telling me, and not that I got a big ego, as a matter of fact, it was the opposite. I started imploding. I started getting smaller and smaller and feeling more and more insecure. I did the first record. I worked. It was fun. I did it. The second record, I worked and worked and worked and worked and worked. Everybody says, oh, yeah, wait till you get to your second record, it's really hard. And I was like, nah, it's not gonna be really hard. It was. I just realized, I guess for the first time in my life, that what I had, like, a record. And to do it, I really, really wanted to do a great job on it. They didn't really know what they wanted, they just knew that what they were hearing wasn't right, you know. So that was the only feedback that I was getting, that's not it. But doesn't it make you feel something? That's not the point. Well, what is the point then? Why am I here? Why are you here? But so, I mean, that was kind of a shock, you know, the whole, that it's very much a money-making machine. You know, in retrospect, it wasn't all that bad thing, because they just made me write more songs.
I just really, really wanted to make a great record, please myself. Wanted to do it my way. I'm proud of it. I've never been proud of anything before. So this is kind of a new feeling.
This time I went to them beforehand, before I went into the studio, and said I'd like to finish the record on my own without any input from you, and then at the end we'll give it to you, and if you choose to put it out, then you can. And they said, yeah, surprisingly enough. And every song, we'd filter them songs as we finished them, and every song's a single. So that seemed to be the right way to do it. I think this record is actually darker than the last two, simply because I go a lot deeper into my own
emotions and stuff, but also other people's lives, and I've always tried to portray a sense of hope. The nicest thing about fumbling is that for the first time in my life, I feel like I was able to write from a spiritually high place instead of a spiritually low place. It was an amazing spiritual discovery that I could exist on that level and be happy. And it was a completely new level for me. And the song started coming out amazingly easily at that point. The intensity of the fantasies that were created in these letters, where I was placed into their worlds that they had created for me and them. It was kind of disturbing, and so I sort of wrote that song to separate myself from that, and also to understand, to get into their brains and sort of say, well, because most of them are very harmless, they're just lost souls. We all have similar emotions, it's just some people take it to a greater degree. Very driven, and when I'm out, I tour and tour and tour, and I love playing live. And it's my problem is balance. I have a real hard time sort of knowing when to quit.
Near the end of Fumbling and near the end of Solace, when I was on the road for too long, I would actually get angry at people, not to their face, but afterwards, because they'd be telling me how fantastic I was, and I felt horrible about myself, and so I didn't feel like I deserved it. And I said, what is wrong with you? Can't you see how messed up I am?
I started losing myself, and started buying into all the things people were telling me, and not that I got a big ego, as a matter of fact, it was the opposite. I started imploding. I started getting smaller and smaller and feeling more and more insecure.
Really? I've been out too long. I don't know who the hell I am anymore. I've become this little tiny thing, disintegrating from the inside. You start doing things that you would never do if you were in your right mind and clear-headed.
And start hating myself because I was doing things for all the wrong reasons, but I couldn't see through it anymore. But, you know, these are all amazing learning curves, because then I wrote Fumbling after that, which is a really joyful record because I went through hell and sort of, you know, came through it and found a stronger me. I really want to figure myself out. I have this real drive to know myself. And I think that comes from, I need to know myself because everybody else is telling me who I am. I should know myself who I am. And so I'm always, you know, asking myself questions. It's weird for me because being in a spotlight too, I'm not merely the individual Sarah McLachlan. I'm the singer, songwriter, spokesperson for my generation, Sarah McLachlan. And it puts me in a different light. I realized a long time ago that the image and the perceptions that people have of me have very little to do with me, the person I know as Sarah. It has a lot to do with, you know, the icon and the celebrity and the person that they've built me up to be through the interviews and the pictures that they've seen. And as long as I have that healthy distance, it's fine.
Basically, magazines and newspapers, whatever, they have to make sexy copy. It has to look good. It has to jump off the page and make people want to buy the magazine and read it. So it's always a bit sensationalistic and glamorized. It was frustrating because I often felt that no matter what I said, it got manipulated and put into something that would be a little more exciting than what I said, ultimately.
Do you ever feel that you want to dispel the notion of the sweet and good girl, Sarah?
Oh, there's no point. I've given up trying to dispel the misconceptions because it doesn't do any good. It just builds more.
I get a lot of video treatments with me on a white horse with billowing robes behind me and stuff.
my best and dearest friend, you know, the love of my life, my girlfriend, and I went through hell because I fell in love with her ex, my now husband, Ash.
Oh, really?
And so
wow.
That was a really, really hard thing for all of us. It was a wild and crazy time.
Performing's amazing, and it's a great drug. It's a great high. It's a great confidence booster. But I think the real work is in the songwriting for me, in the process.
I realize how incredibly hard it is to write good songs. And, you know, I'm scared. I mean, what if I can't write a good album next time? You know, I've got 8 albums to do now.
I've learned some tricks, but I don't know if it's become any easier. It seems maybe in a lot of ways it's become harder. The songwriting process has always been extremely cathartic for me. Typically, it's an emotional response to something, whether it's something in my life or something that I see other people close to me experiencing, or people completely outside of myself. Whatever triggers some sort of emotional response in me that enables me to write.
Emotions, the need to sort through stuff, past things that are haunting me, situations where I find other people in that I can relate to. The human condition is fascinating to me.
You know, I wasn't always talking about bubbly, happy things. It was more the dark side, which I'm fascinated by in myself and in everybody. And I think with this record, I've just gone a little deeper into that, you know, into realizing how big my dark side is.
I sort of touched on a lot of the issues in Fumbling and then kind of went away and sort of blocked everything out again. And with Surfacing, I think I went even deeper into those areas that I sort of and touched on and, you know, really tried to sort through them and deal with them in a lot of ways. Not necessarily coming out in the music, but in my own personal life. And these are just sort of songs or chain reactions of trying to deal with that stuff. So, yeah, it's definitely a continuation.
Surfacing as a record was probably the hardest record I ever had to make, and probably because it was the most personal, and I had to do a lot of work on myself to get back to a place where I was comfortable with myself.
I'm pretty ruthless for myself now, and I don't know, that has a bit to do with age, therapy, you know? A fantastic husband, I have a really solid relationship. He's incredibly supportive. I have fantastic friends, you know, and I worked through a lot with my friends too in the past 4 years. You know, my best and dearest friend, you know, the love of my life, my girlfriend, and I went through hell because I fell in love with her ex, my now husband, Ash.
Oh, really?
And so
wow.
That was a really, really hard thing for all of us. You know, her probably more than anybody. So we went through a long period of just, you know,
working it out,
and now we're back together again, which is just, thank God.
I love him so much, and I don't think I could be out here if he wasn't out here with me, so.
It was a wild and crazy time, let me tell you. But and again, another record came out of it. You know, a lot of Surfacing is from that. You know, really having to look at myself in a completely different light. you know, the light that my friend put me in, the light that I was in, it was very painful, but refreshing at the same time, too, and I could actually look at it and go, okay, well, this is okay. I can still like myself. Fair, and basically it's a festival of women in music. It's a celebration of the fact that, well, really over the past 5 to 6 years there's been a huge turnaround in the music industry, where, I mean, 4 years ago even two women couldn't get played back to back on a radio station, to the point where now they're dominating the airwaves, and if you look on the Billboard top 20, it's half women. It's about damn time. And it's by no means man-hating or man-excluding. It's simply a celebration of the fact that women are being really successful, and there's a lot of incredible talent out there, and I want to showcase that. It's very timely, I think, for something like this to happen. Less than 3 years ago, when I started out on Fumbling, I had a lot of females opening up for me, and I had a lot of promoters saying, oh, you can't put two females on the same bill. And so a bit of it's reactionary. It's like, well, I'm going to show you, you know. The people out there want this. They want an alternative. You know, they're sick and tired of all the cock rock in the world. And, you know, bless their hearts. I love that kind of music, too. It's got its place and time. But this is just to offer an alternative.
What would you like to see Welychka change in the industry?
Well, obviously the perceptions that women are a fad. I think this is a really positive step in the right direction for women in general. I think this is important for a feminist stance. I also think it's important for a musical stance.
Part of the fun about putting something like Welychka on is obviously you need the big acts to draw the people, but if you have that platform, it's an amazing opportunity to create a good situation for younger and developing artists, which is why we started the B and the C stage, to get people up there to play in front of way more people than they could on their own.
What's the best part about coming to a thing like this?
Like, you get to see other people that you haven't seen before live.
Ever.
This is probably one of the coolest events I've heard of and have hoped to go to for a while. Wicked lineup of music, really cool atmosphere, just all around really good time.
It's a really cool vibe here. I mean, just it's so peaceful. Most concerts you sort of wait for a fight to break out, and here you just sort of relax.
She put together a really good festival celebrating music with women, and that's why we all come here.
Yeah, it's pretty much blown my mind daily. I mean, I didn't go into this with huge expectations, although I will say that I did think it would be successful, and I thought a lot of people would come. I didn't think that every show would sell out, and I certainly didn't expect the media hype.
It's pretty damn impressive, isn't it?
I presume you've all had a good day so far. Excellent.
I think definitely nothing like this to this scale has been done before, so it's a first in that way. This is a definite kick in the pants to the industry. I mean, it's going to change a lot of old values. You look at the charts, and for the first time, there's in the top 10, there's 4 or 5 women. Whereas 5, 10 years ago, there was maybe one. It would have been Madonna or Janet Jackson, you know, and it would have been, you know, that huge pop star, pop icon. Now there's, you know, it's different. There's singer-songwriters up there in the charts, and it's a nice change to see. It's a good progression. You know, I look so forward to the time when we're not women musicians, we're just musicians.
We've just heard great things about the tour, that all the artists, there's a lot of camaraderie, and they jam together backstage and perform together on stage, and there aren't a lot of tours that do that.
We're calling it Camp Lilith. It's like summer camp, because basically all the artists' dressing room doors are open, everybody's playing acoustic guitar on the floor and sitting around singing each other's songs. It's just a really great, positive, ego-free energy. There's no hierarchy. We're all doing the same thing. We're all out here making music, having fun, and so that's the spirit.
Oh, it's music. Revolutionary.
It's so virtually utopian that if the world outside the little fair were more like this, I'd want to spend more time out there, you know?
So I started weakening, and I started thinking, oh, God, maybe I keep going on about how egalitarian this whole thing is. Maybe I should add men just to please everybody. It's like, f*** that. It bothered me because I started succumbing to the thing of what everybody else wanted. And bless her heart, Emmylou Harris was the one who sort of, she came up to me one day before a press conference and she said, you know, it might not be my place to say to you, but, you know, we've been doing these press conferences and it's, I think it's really sad and a mistake if you want to add men to this because it's so beautiful what's happening and it's so important. It was so clear to me as soon as she said it, she said, you're absolutely right. I don't even know where I was, you know, going with that. It's just, I was starting to succumb to the pressure, so. And then, of course, I got asked that question. I was like, no, I've decided I don't want to. It's going very well, thank you, and why mess it up?
Sarah's never made this into, like, just an all-girl thing. She made this as a point, I think, for the industry.
You were criticized for absolutely every reason. It was either too soft or too hard or too country or not country enough. And we just realized very early on that we had to be ruthless to our own intentions, that we had to remain true to what we wanted to do, which was try and put on a really amazing and diverse and unique music festival.
And the only time I ever felt that anyway was in the press conferences when people, of course, had to ask the questions they had to ask. And but the audiences have always got it.
We sort of always had a 3-year plan right from the start. This is going to be the last year for a good long while. That could be 3 years, it could be 10 years, it could be never. I'm not really sure at this point. We're sort of realizing that we're all into our 30s and we want to have babies, and it's sort of one or the other.
You're giving up Lilith to have babies, essentially.
I think she was really smart. I think these things can really only have a certain shelf life before they become stale. I think we're getting out while the getting's good.
I think we've been able to give audiences an amazing show, a really good musical show with a lot of diversity. I think we've been able to show them a lot of joy, yeah, and a lot of fun, and that women can do something like this and be very successful at it and have a great time doing it. I think it's really important, especially for young women, to see that the options are pretty much unlimited now.
The fact that when we began, many radio programmers said you shouldn't play two women back to back on the radio, and you couldn't put two women on the same bill. People won't come. Well, did we prove them wrong?
My ideas for Lilith started out so simply in the first place. We want to be socially responsible, so we got involved with a lot of charities.
We gave like $1 of every ticket sale locally to women's shelters. We're going to carry that over into the CD. We just basically want to cover our costs and give the rest to charity.
Really great to be able to give $15,000 or something in one day to a local shelter, and you can see how much that money means to them. I've always had the desire as an individual to give something back on a personal level, and this is just, it's such a great platform. It's a large platform, and we have the ability to give a lot back.
I consider myself a humanist first and foremost, and I believe that encompasses feminism, the idea that we should all be treated equally. We should all have equal rights, access to everything that men do. But you know, the same could be said for a lot of minority groups. There's so much inequality on so many levels. And I think as a humanist and a feminist, that's what I'm striving for. World Vision doesn't get to them first, to these girls, and the pimps will, and, you know, they'll offer them money or whatever, and they don't really know it's prostitution, I don't think, you know. They come with good intentions, and they get led astray pretty easily.
It completely changed my life. I think it changed all of our lives. I don't know how it couldn't, really.
I have the pull, I have the power, I have the financial backing to do these kind of things. Every day is something very different, and it's entertaining. There's no time
no time to complain or to say, I'm working 16-hour days, I'm so tired. It's kind of great to fall into bed exhausted every night. Right. You know you've been doing something that way, you know. It feels really good to be able to do something like this. My mother passed away from cancer just last December, right before Christmas. It was just in that moment where I was so deeply affected by it that it's absolutely I'll do anything to help. I was very, very lucky as a kid. I had, you know, I was very middle class upbringing. My parents gave me all the private music lessons I wanted, all the art classes I wanted, and I got it in school as well. Well, most kids don't have that. I wouldn't have gone. I would have dropped out. It's the only reason I stayed in high school. It's pretty amazing to watch some of these kids who, at the beginning, a lot of them had never even picked up an instrument before, and some of them getting proficient. And you see the look of pride on their faces and how happy they were and how proud. It's just fantastic. I use my celebrity to endorse these things because people tend to listen more. And so it's a great platform. I still am not at all interested in the star thing and the fame thing. You know, I think everybody's a star. When I see success is when I go and play in a town and I see a lot of happy faces in the audience. That's when I see success. I don't see it when I see my name on a chart somewhere. Yeah. As far as I'm concerned, it's already a success, regardless of what happens after this. I'm happy with the record. I'm ready to put it out. It's a huge weight lifted off my shoulders, so everything else, I know what this job demands. Come out at night,
that's when the energy comes. It's hard to relate any statistics to reality for me. Will we Canadians will feel a little tinge of pride when that happens down there.
A little tinge of lots.
A lot of people say Sarah built her career off of Lilith, but I think her career was already built and done.
Certainly the momentum with the press started with Lilith Fair. I think I had built up a very solid fan base before that because I had been touring for a number of years. Within the industry's eyes, definitely, all of a sudden. And Lilith did catapult me into a very different, you know, bracket of fame.
Never wanted to be famous. I wanted to make music. I did love, and I still do love, playing live. I love that adulation. I love the connection and the sharing of energy that happens between myself, the band, and the audience. I mean, it's the best high in the world when it's on and when it works. It's really nice to feel loved. Who in their right mind wouldn't enjoy that?
I mean, we were a kid down east. You certainly couldn't have had that as an aspiration. I want to be a star.
Well, I kind of did.
but I didn't really think what star meant. I knew I wanted to be doing something in the arts, doing something creative, and I knew pretty early that I loved to sing and I loved to entertain people. So I really, you know, I had that kind of dream for all my life, although I, you know, got it pounded into me from a very early age that was not a realistic dream.
Right.
So it was kind of at the back of my mind. So it was pretty amazing when it kind of came true.
I still am not at all interested in the star thing and the fame thing. You know, I think everybody's a star, personally, you know, in their own little, their own worlds and for their own reasons. But as far as fame and the pedestal that society places you upon when you're a famous person, I don't place much value in that.
I've just been very lucky to have a lot of people around me with a lot of knowledge in certain areas that have really, you know, been a great help. None of these things I would have been able to do completely on my own. It's all a team effort, every single thing I've ever done. Well, we kind of grew up together. They've been great because they've always educated me on how the business works, as opposed to just, you know, keeping the artist in the dark. We've lived and learned together.
Do you think you would have had this career if you'd never met them?
I don't know. I don't think about that too often, but I may well not have, because I was never sort of I've never been a very good self-promoter. The only reason they heard me in the first place was because I was with a band that somebody else had started, and they had sent songs that we had recorded. I probably never would have thought to do that. So I'd probably be making jewelry somewhere. I think fate has a very strong hand in these things, you know, when you surround yourself with people of like minds and like desires. You choose the way you choose your friends, the way you choose your lovers or whatever. It's there's rhyme and reason to it.
I've been really lucky that things have happened to me slowly enough that I've been able to sort of deal with them as they come for the most part.
I sort of feel like I was pretty lucky that I got to grow into success sort of quietly, because unlike people like, you know, Britney Spears or Alanis, who were really, really young, like the same age as me, starting out, instant, huge success. I mean, that's a lot for a 19-year-old to wrap their head around. And I was lucky. I went out, I put my record out. I had a nice little bit of success. I sold, I think, 50,000 records, which is a lot of records, but, you know, in the world's industry's eyes now, that's nothing. That's a failure. And I played to 150 people in a club, and then it was 200, then it was 400, and just slowly, over 10 years, it just slowly got bigger. And so I really had a chance to deal with it in small increments, which I think was really necessary for me to keep my head above water with it all. You know, the whole fame thing, it's sort of, I find myself very separate from Sarah McLachlan, the celebrity, the entertainer. It's like, I'm just still Sarah from the block, you know, I'm just still me.
Love Sarah McLachlan. She's my idol.
Sarah, yeah, for sure. Yeah, I dig her.
Everything she does for women alone is just fantastic.
You feel like you sort of know her, yeah. Even though you don't know her, but you feel she's so nice.
You're a role model.
I know.
I don't mind that anymore. For a long time, I didn't feel very comfortable being a role model, and probably mostly because a lot of the times I was being called that, I wasn't feeling very comfortable with myself. With Lilith, I think I was so proud of what I was doing. I was so proud to be a part of it, and every element of it was so positive. It made it much easier for me to feel comfortable in that position. I love to give any opportunity to young women to be able to show them that I am out there doing something I love. I'm being able to make a living doing it, and it's a very positive thing, and I think that's a really good image to project. I live my life in a way that seems right for me. I treat people the way I would like to be treated. And I just do the best I can. And that's really all you can do as a role model, whether it's me as a celebrity or me as a mother. Everybody is a role model to somebody. We go throughout our lives
And the more and more you learn, the more you can lose your innocence, because there's a lot of horrible things out there. And, you know, I think one of the ultimate goals for me is trying to maintain a sense of wonder. For me, that's what I mean by we are, you know, we're born that way. If we got there once, we can get back to it. You know, there is a road, there is a path back. I think you can be childlike and, you know, yet maintain a great sense of wisdom as well. Trying to find a way to carry on. I want to go get my butt pregnant. I'm ready to have kids.
That's a new thing for you to feel that way, isn't it?
No. I felt this way a long time. I know I've always wanted to have children. I've had glimpses at it, but I feel really ready, like I've been ready for a while. And it's sort of, it's staying there. That feeling, that calm is staying with me, which is really good, as opposed to being fleeting. Heaven bent to take my hand and lead me through the fire. Be the long-awaited answer to a long and painful fight. It's so incredibly profound and beautiful and terrifying and all at once. They don't see, it's one misstep, one slip before you know it. Life intervened and there was no time for writing, there was no energy to write. It was all about just, you know, dealing with what was happening, either with my mother or me having morning sickness, or after my daughter was born, she had colic for 5 months. Yeah, there was no time to think about music really, so I sort of wrote it in pockets of time.
She toured her butt off for years and really had to work to get what she got. And so when all of a sudden she didn't have to do that, she really took advantage of it. I don't really blame her. You know, she's earned everything that she's got, but I'll tell you, it's so nice to hear her voice again.
He and everybody else was so patient with me. I'm the one that self-inflicted so much pressure and so much worry about when this record was going to come out, if it was ever going to be finished, if the songs were any good. You know, my manager smiles at me and says, you say that every time, you go through the same thing every time, you question everything. This time was particularly bad though. I'm really proud of this record, and a lot of that has to do with the fact that it was such a hard album for me to write and to finish. Because for a time there, I hated all of it. I thought it was crap. I thought I couldn't write anymore. I thought, you know, it's time to give it up. It's not working. And everybody's gonna assume that it's gonna be all about being a mom or losing my mom, and no, it's all about stuff that I'm still working through from 10 years ago. I'm slow to process. So if I had the chance, love, you know I would not hesitate. The thing about life is always offering up obstacles which you can either fall over or jump over. You know, and depending on where you are in your life, if you're not that strong, which I'm not always that strong, I'm gonna fall. But those mistakes are where you learn the most.
Some of my best stuff has come out of mistakes.
Change happens whether you like it or not, so you either get on board or you fall on your butt. So I choose to get on board.
No, I don't think I'd do anything differently.
Oh, I'm kind of happy to say I don't think I've made any really bad decisions. I've been pretty lucky thus far. I have a whole lot of stuff that brightens my day. I'm very, very lucky. I have fantastic friends. I have a wonderful husband, a great kid. Life is good. Life is really good.
Perfect. Yeah.